It's official.
As Jimmy White takes that final black, Stephen Hendry leading by only 2 frames now at 14 frames to 12.
Pretty determined, Jimmy White, going out for the interval. We're approaching ours, another programme, of course, later. A possible 5 left in the match. Hendry needs 2, White needs 4. The winner plays Nigel Bond in this year's Embassy World Final. See you later for this one to a finish.
Hello. Like any normal superstar, I always spend my Friday nights down the laundrette. We all do, me, Cilla, Barrymore. Well, I'm about to spend a night at a derelict mental hospital. Ooh, scary. And I'll be trying to explode some of the more popular myths about mental illness. Hang about. These aren't mine. Oi, Cilla, you dropped a pair.
Joe Brown goes back to Bedlam Wednesday at 10 on BBC2.
On Monday on BBC Two, The Talking Cure. Face-to-face therapy. What is it? Does it work?
If you speak to 20 psychiatrists, you'll get 20 different answers.
I would sit and talk, and nothing actually changed.
It's not a matter of it either works or it doesn't work. It can actually have harmful effects.
They'll never get bored by anything you have to say, and they'll always be an attentive ear.
The Talking Cure, Monday, 10 past 8 on BBC Two.
Eddie Izzard and Michael Winner will be putting their wits on the line in 20 minutes on BBC Two. Have I got news for you? Now on BBC Two, in the States of Mind season, actress Imogen Stubbs talks frankly about how her life was turned upside down by the enemy within.
Tonight, I'll be talking about one of the most misunderstood and yet one of the most common mental health problems, panic attacks. 1 in 20 of us will have a disabling panic attack at some time in our lives. Here to share her experience of them is a woman who went to Oxford University to read English and got a first, became an actress and a member of the Royal Shakespeare Company. Although still only 34, she has won great acclaim as a classical actress. She has performed Shakespeare and D.H. Lawrence on television and recently played the popular TV private eye, Anna Lee.
Well, is he really her father?
Some of us have important work to do, so if you'll excuse me.
You pompous prat.
She is Imogen Stubbs. Tell me about the first panic attack that you had.
Well, the first time, I think it was when I was about 21. And I'd just left university and gone to RADA, and I think I was in my second term at RADA, and we had the Easter holidays, we had 5 weeks, so I went to Mexico with a friend. And after a couple of weeks there, we were on a little plane, about the third plane we'd been on in one day. And the person I was with looked at me and said, oh, you look a kind of green colour, you look very strange. And I said, oh, no, it's fine, I'll just go and lie down in the aisle and then I think I'll feel fine. And I got up and we were on one of those little tiny planes with only about 14 people in it. And I lay down in the aisle, and as I lay down, I'd felt this strange kind of tingling feeling in my lips and my hands, but as I lay down, I felt like a sumo wrestler. It sort of sat on my chest and my arms flicked back and my head, sort of everything went. I went in completely, kind of got lockjaw and I went completely paralysed. Although my eyes sort of stayed open and I was unable to communicate anything, although my brain still was functioning. I was sort of stretched off and taken to a very primitive hospital. And the man tried everything. He kind of pumped my chest and stuck things all over me and he tried masses of things and eventually I think they thought I had a brain tumour or something at first, but eventually he gave me a tranquilizer. He tried to tranquilize in sort of desperation, I think. And little by little, I felt like getting into a hot bath when you've been freezing cold. I felt the warmth sort of coming back into my fingers and my body and my lips. I started to feel this heat coming back in. I suppose it was like being reborn. I mean, I think it was the happiest moment of my life. Mm. And I came out of it and I seemed completely unimpaired. I mean, seemed to be completely fine. And the next day, it happened again.
Exactly the same.
Exactly the same thing. You know, this thing. And I had a very few seconds. You know, I said, oh, it's happening again. And within 10 seconds, I was paralysed again.
And before it happened, in that short period beforehand, did you feel a sense of anxiety or apprehension?
Literally just before it happened, I felt a tingling feeling here and here and a heaviness in my limbs. And I suppose maybe a difficulty in breathing.
Yes. Did you feel, for example, palpitations? Did you
yes,
feel your heart
beating?
Yes, absolutely.
Felt like I was having a heart attack.
Yeah. Your mouth, was it dry?
All those things.
Sweating?
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, when I started getting more and more and more, I started to sort of take note of
sure.
which symptoms. The first time I had it, I had pains, little pains all over me as well. But also, for ages, I tried to fight it. And it kept happening to me. So in the end, kind of, we flew back. Obviously, you know, immediately went to the local doctors we went to a lot of different doctors, some people said it was my age, other people said, you know, you've just got to pull yourself together, just don't worry about it. I mean, quite early on, people came up with, I don't know if they came up with the phrase panic attack. It's a phrase much more used now than it was
yes.
then. I think it was identified sort of certainly early on as a breathing problem.
As an actress, you would have, I mean, your breathing would have been something you'd paid some attention to.
Well, I suppose it was at the beginning
of
I mean, I was learning to be an actress. I was an apprentice,
yeah.
and I've always been a terribly shallow breather, and I think at RADA they were training us to breathe very, very deeply. And I suppose it's something you do instinctively, so the minute breathing doesn't become instinctive and you're trying to, you know, change your diaphragm and widen your back and all those things, it's quite a dangerous thing to tamper with. I mean, I'm not sure if that's why I had it, but I'd certainly been trying to breathe differently.
And did it then sort of spread? You then began to get panicky about getting panicky?
Well, once... yes, I then began to get panicky about getting panicky. And also, after a while in England, doctors told me to breathe into paper bags and things like that, which...
Did they explain why?
They said it would help, but they didn't explain enough
no.
why. And, you know, you bring out a paper bag on the tube and breathe into it, people think you're a glue sniffer or something, and you feel very silly. But every day, almost in a cycle, I seem to be going through tingly feelings in my hands and lips and little pains where I'd broken limbs and things.
Yeah.
And sometimes I was hallucinating. I was having a strange thing where I could start a sentence and not finish it, but I could remember very vividly things from when I was very young. And I was getting these funny, achy, heavy limbs and a sort of general dizziness and this palpitations at night. I used to sleep with a phone beside my... I mean, in the end, I actually moved back to my mother's, where my mother lived, because I was so frightened. I thought I'd die at night time. I thought I was going to have a heart attack because my heart was beating so fast. And just more. And the more these things happen, the more frightened you're
sure.
in a bell jar with them. And I also realised that I was starting to get very nervous in... I kind of find it very difficult to get on tube trains or small spaces, and I found neon light. I started to wonder if it was a form of epilepsy or something. I'd find neon, anything flickering or television, pretty much everything. I even got slightly words like aeroplane and Mexico and, you know, stuff.
Would what trigger it off?
Yes, to a certain degree. Yeah. I mean, not catastrophically. I mean, instinctively, I suppose instinctively I learned to fight it slightly. And I did notice at drama school that when I was doing exercise, I felt much better.
Yeah.
When I wasn't thinking about breathing, inevitably, when I stopped thinking about breathing and just it took over, you know, like as when you're doing a sport, your breathing just does what it's going to do, I felt a lot better. It was nighttime.
Yes.
That was very, very frightening.
Because you would become conscious of your breathing, would you?
I was conscious of every breath. And by the end of 6 months, I was very desperate. I was terribly... I found it very, very hard to go to sleep at night. And I think after a certain point, I found it each day. I just dreaded each day going by because I knew I was going to go through all these things. I was terrified of humiliating myself in front of people and having one of these attacks.
How desperate did you get? I mean, did you ever get to the stage where you felt you just couldn't go on?
Oh, yes, I definitely did. And I think ostensibly to everyone else, I looked like I had the best life in the world.
Yeah.
I was at RADA, I had lots of friends. And I never went out. I mean, I became very hermit-like. But I do remember once lying down just thinking, I think I'd rather die than live like this.
Really?
I was so debilitated by it. And so... And I do remember thinking, oh, this is what it's like to be on the other side.
The other side?
The other side of what people consider sort of rational human beings. Or it's very hard. I've always been a very positive person. And I think when people say I'm very depressed or something, you think, oh, go and make some meringues or hitchhike or, you know, get a life. It's when you become somebody who's in a state that's hard to communicate to other people, hard for them to empathise with, it is very frightening. You feel you're very, very alone. And at the time, I mean, I'm so pleased now that there's much more information about it, but at the time I never met anyone who said, oh, I've got that,
yeah.
or oh, that sounds familiar to
yes.
me. Nobody did. Everyone looked at me like I was from outer space. And I remember somebody suggested I went to a rest home for 9 months. And I think the more people are telling you that possibly it's psychological, the more you panic, because it's something that's stigmatized and you think, it can't happen to me, I'm a happy person, everything's fine. Yeah. And the more, also, I think I fought it because I knew that whatever was happening to me was something physical that I felt could be cured.
Yeah, I was going to say, did you at any stage feel, this is a nervous, I am disintegrating, I'm breaking up?
Yes, I did, definitely. But I also got into a stage, I think maybe a lot of people do, of superstition. That I, you know, I did keep, people kept saying, just pull yourself together. And I kept thinking, oh, maybe it's happening because I'm drinking tea, or maybe if I brush my teeth in 25 seconds. I mean, all sorts of other silly things happen, because you become desperate for a remedy.
Did you find yourself taking tranquilizers?
I did for a very limited time. I mean, I was given Valium, and unquestionably it works, because it makes you a complete zombie, so you don't really feel anything. But I think I found... I suppose I found the fact that I was taking Valium more depressing than anything, because it felt like it wasn't a solution, it was a fobbing off. Yeah. And I felt the feeling of feeling that zombie-ish was worse than anything, so I flushed them down the loo and didn't take them.
So then what happened? Because you did get help.
Well, I did. Somebody recommended a homeopathic doctor. And I went to see this woman, and she said, you know, before you tell me, I'm going to tell you and see if this sounds familiar. Are you, you know, hallucinating, getting little pains, getting tingly things, getting aching, having this terrible night, palpitations, heavy thing? She
sweating,
went through the whole list.
Dry
and
mouth,
I,
dizzy legs.
Everything. And I thought, you know, I thought, who is this wonderful woman? I said, yes, yes. And she said, you know, not only can I identify what you've got, but I can promise you I can cure it. And I felt like I'd met Jesus. You know, it was absolutely incredible. And she proceeded to do that. And she also gave me...
What did she do?
Well, she gave me some articles written by various people which absolutely articulated what I was going through. And that is the most wonderful thing in the world, to feel that there are people out there who are not only generally aware of what's happening, but specifically understand what you're going through. And, you know, I think one of them was called hypercarbonation or hyperventilation. And she also had a strange machine which measured carbon dioxide. And instead of asking me about sort of incidents that had happened in my life, and she totally concentrated on my physicality and said, you know, breathe in here. Yes. There's like some sort of tube thing. And she said, well, you've got, you know, virtually no carbon dioxide in your body.
She was explaining that your shallow breathing was clearing it off and your carbon dioxide was very low, and you got these tingling feelings.
Well, and explained why
panicked.
And, yes, and explained why that mattered. I mean, nobody had ever really told me. I always thought you didn't want carbon dioxide, so you should breathe it all out.
Whereas, in fact, you need a...
You need a little bit, and I think people don't realise that.
And this was the explanation for the paper bag, that if you breathed in, you kept your carbon dioxide
and so suddenly,
level up.
Yes, and suddenly everything started to make sense. And it was a bit like learning how to mend your own car or something. You know, it's like, you know, suddenly... It was so exciting to not only have something explained to you, but someone to say, and you're going to do it yourself, and I'm going to help you cure yourself.
That was important to you?
Very important to me, and that there won't be lasting damage.
But what was... She did... there were certain behaviours, things you had to do when the
symptoms
threatened.
Well, she referred me to a physiotherapist.
Yeah, tell me a bit about that.
Well, I used to go every week and a couple of times a week, and I'd lie down on a bed, and she sort of started to teach me to retrain my breathing, not in terms of all my life, but in terms of if I felt an attack coming on, which by then I could identify very quickly, a kind of almost like mnemonics or something, but a way of breathing that would fight the attack. And it was very simple. It was like breathe in, two, three, out, two, three. I mean, it was something extremely simple, which I just had to completely focus on and try out. And one time after a few months, I remember lying there, and it was such a specific image. I remember feeling like I'd been somewhere on the bottom of an ocean under this huge, heavy weight of water in this sort of dark, lonely area, and that I'd been gradually floating up to the surface. And then one time when I was there, I felt like I just kind of... It's a rather corny image, but I felt like I'd burst through into the sunshine, through the water, and that I'd sort of made it back onto another side. And I'd never had it since then. I mean, it was a very specific... One day, I just thought, I've done it, I've beaten it, you know, it was a wonderful sensation. Sure. And
the treatment gave you back control.
Yes.
You presumably regulated your breathing. You deepened it. You slowed it. And of course, you knew that it would work. You found it worked. And once you had that, you had something that would
see you
through.
And a sort of self-respect. I mean, I think for some reason it felt like, with that regained control came a sort of a confidence. A confidence in yourself that you're in control of yourself.
Now, when you look back, why do you think you had it?
I don't know. I mean, certainly Mexico I found very shocking, and it's very high altitude, so it's hard breathing anyway. And I had this Montezuma's Revenge, where I was quite shockingly ill. I'd never been that ill.
Yes.
So
you say high altitude. Did you feel dizzy at that altitude?
Well,
anyway,
Mexico City is very high up.
Yeah.
And I was in a horrible incident in a huge wave, one of those big waves that sort of roll around, which moved down a beach where I was swimming. And suddenly this wall of water was coming towards us and everyone was trying to run to get out of it. And I got caught up in it and thrown onto the beach. And I was all right, but a girl next to me was killed. Yeah. And I think that shocked me enormously. And we were sort of held up at knife point and there were rabid dogs. I'd just never been anywhere like that.
Well, let me ask you about your role as an actress. Do you see any similarities between ordinary stage fright? I don't mean the paralysing kind. I mean the kind of stage anxiety that actors and actresses get.
I suppose on a very superficial level, that sort of sweatiness and an adrenaline. But I've seen someone else have a... I mean, one of the joys of having a panic attack is I can recognise someone else having one. And recently I saw another actor having one who was terrified of talking about it or anything, and I was in a nice position to say, you know, in my own way to say, look, not only can I see what's happening to you, but I also know you can cure it. And
is that why? Nice. Is that why you're doing this?
I remember thinking, if only I'd ever seen someone else talk about it or read about it or met someone else who'd had it, I wouldn't have felt so alone, and I think it would have been very healthy for me to kind of be able to share the experiences with somebody else.
The problem, as you know, is that there's the stigma that surrounds any kind of admission that you've had something like this.
Yes, I think that's so wrong. I mean, to me, in the world we live in, it's abnormal not to panic about life, if that's what it is one's doing. I mean, we're all burdened with so many horrors, everybody, that I think panicking is a fairly normal state to be in. And what, to me, is extraordinary are people who, you know, if you're not confused by life, you can't be paying attention, because it strikes me that we live in a very, very frightening world. And it is... I find that stigmatising thing so wrong, but I can see how it happens. And before I had a panic attack, if someone said to me, I've got a phobia about kittens, you know, we'd all think, well, that's just silly, they're lovely little fluffy creatures, but some people probably do have phobias about kittens. And I certainly, you know, I feel an enormous sympathy with people now.
Imogen, in your case, regulating your breathing held the key. In other cases, I know that giving people control of their muscles, or getting them to so that they can control their heart rate and feel much more in control of their physical symptoms holds the key. Mm. Some people, of course, medication helps in the sense it breaks the cycle and then they get control, or they carry it round with them and that almost prevents the attack happening. Mm. They feel, well, if it's going to happen, I have something to take which will relieve it.
Like an aspirin card or something.
That's right. But so it's very variable. But what's common to most of the techniques that are now done by behaviour therapists and psychologists and others calls for a certain amount of discipline on the part of the person. There are things you have to do, and you have to do them in a certain order, and you have to do them every time.
You have to make time for them. I'm terrified I'm sounding smug, making it sound easy, because it is. I was in a very fortunate situation that I had time to concentrate on those things. If I lived in a high-rise block of flats with millions of children and no money, an enormous amount of problems coming in, and maybe a partner who wasn't, or people around me who weren't as sympathetic or as understanding, I think you can become a very irritating, a very precious, a very wimpy, unattractive person, all these things are happening to you, because you seem to be so self-indulgent and self-centred. And the curing yourself does take compassion from other people and patience with you, and the discipline of kind of if somebody tells you you've got to breathe at various times, you really have to make time to do that and make sure you've done it and check up on yourself.
But, you know, there are theories about how panic disorder occurs. People will speculate on your sexuality, on your early childhood experience, on the importance for you of control and losing control. Presumably that's...
I encountered a lot of that. And
people would have encouraged you to go into therapy,
I think. Said they did, and that wasn't for me, and I didn't believe. I never felt that was the right way to confront this particular problem. I can't speak for everyone, but that very approach made me feel worse.
Did any of it make any sense to you?
None at all. No, and even if someone said, well, the reason this is happening to you is because you sat on your gerbil when you were six, I can't see how that would help.
So in your case, the physical model of the symptoms occurring, perhaps because you were under a lot of stress and then taking over, that makes sense to you.
It made sense to me, and by believing in that, it cured me. I can't speak for everyone. I do know that to say I'm having panic attacks, what's wrong with me is I'm suffering from anxiety, feels demeaning, but to say what I have is hypercarbia or hyperventilation, that felt all right.
Yes. Imogen Stubbs, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
On Monday night, Adam Faith reveals his battle with post-traumatic stress. That's at 7:50. If you'd like to talk to someone in confidence about any issue raised by tonight's programme, there's a free phone helpline staffed by trained counsellors. The number's 0800 500 800 and lines will be open until 12:30 tonight and every weekday evening.
Great dance smells are now available from Mulligan and O'Hare. 20 smash hits from the men who brought you Cats in Bomber Jackets, The Aroma of the Petermains, Slade and their Cuppa Soups, with guest artists George Michael, Rod Stewart and Matthew Kelly. Scratch and sniff the new smell of Reeves and Mortimer, only available next Friday, 9:30 on BBC Two.
There is nothing wrong with your television. Do not adjust your picture. You are about to experience the awe and mystery that reaches from the deepest inner mind to the outer limits. Enter, if you dare, a place beyond fear and meet... Enter a world where those who dream of immortality discover that the price of admission to the province of the gods is destruction. Enter the Outer Limits.
Get ready for Armageddon.
The channel that brought you the X-Files now brings you to the outer reaches of the human imagination. Television Without Limits, Monday at 9 on BBC Two.
Lashings of the Razor Tongue, now on BBC Two. Have I got news for you?
Good evening and welcome to what is now the world's favourite airline's least favourite programme.